Okay, so that was the people LSTM and in which these people connections provided precise timing. Arkadaşlar içeride olmayan kimse yok değil mi? Şu kapıyı açayım da kapıyı kapalı bırakmışız. And however, there are also some famous variants, which one of which is the multiplicative LSTM. Multiplicative LSTM is an idea of multiplicative recurrent neural networks applied to LSTMs. First, we should understand what a multiplicative RNN is. Well, basically, what a multiplicative RNN is, in a vanilla RNN, you are just convolving the input and output in a linear additive manner, which had the formulas you remember. So this was the vanilla RNN formulas, in which input and output was convolved with this matrix. And when you multiply them with this matrix, actually you're multiplying them with two separate matrices, right? Which is linear nature. In a multiplicative RNN, you change that nature. You make the weights a function of S. It could be a multiplicative function or somewhere other, doesn't matter. What you are doing is you are multiplying the input and the hidden state, that combined vector, with weights which are a function of X. What kind of a function of X does not matter. It could be a function of X which you can learn during the backpropagation, because actually you can think of these as small layers here which have many connections to some inputs. So actually you can learn them. And actually if you learn them, they become specific functions of weights. Those weights become specific functions of the input. So multiplicative RNN is a type of recurrent neural network with multiplicative connections. These multiplication connections actually provide you to relate your weights directly to the input as a function of the input. So instead of the same formula, the weights become not the input weights, but the weights that affect the hidden state becomes a function of X, which you learn during the gradient descent backpropagation. This way of dynamics of the hidden states, now the hidden states change, depends effectively more on the input. I mean, okay, that's what we do in a recurrent neural network. We affect the input so that it changes the hidden state. That's the whole idea of recurrent neural network. I mean, you're asking the same question to the recurrent system. It's providing a different answer each time because of the hidden state. However, you make that relation more complex. And maybe making that relation more complex increases your capacity. And by increasing your capacity, you could learn what you weren't able to learn. We have more control of the dynamics of the states and their relationship with the input. Okay? For example, just a very trivial example, guys. For example, even if this multiplication is zero, imagine for some reason this multiplication is zero, which kills your hidden state. This could be something desirable, but this may not be something desirable. It could be some trivial case. Your function, your weights being a function of the input, may also change that. So you have a more complex dynamics of weights, which will bring you more capacity, guys. That's the whole idea about multiplicative RNNs. And the multiplicative LSTM is exactly that idea implemented to LSTMs. So these weights, or some of these weights, becomes a learnable function of the input. Okay? So the mRNN and LSTM architectures can be combined by adding connections from the mRNN's intermediate states to each gating units. Okay? So the intermediate states of the recurrent multiplicative recurrent gates, these gates, the blue ones, the 10H, you just change it. And how? Let's see, that's the idea. So as you can see, these were the formulas for the input gates, which you simply make them function of X. This will increase your capacity because you are learning more weights It's more complex now. Increasing capacity is good. You will need more, you'll have more capacity to learn more complex things. However, increasing capacity would mean that you would need more data to converge to a better function. And when you have more data, it's more difficult to train and et cetera, et cetera. Okay. I think we've got the idea. I mean, you can just apply this to other gates as well. This gate, or it was the input gates, other gates. As far as I remember, in the multiplicative LSTM, the classic multiplicative LSTM, it is only being applied to the input gate, so that the input is applied in the input gate. However, you can apply. You can always make another part of the, another recurrent part of the LSTM, also a multiplicative one. And also related to the multiplicative LSTM, there is the so-called multiplicative integrated LSTM, which is another paper by Joshua Bengio's team. This Joshua Bengio, I guess, from Montreal again, from where Hinton is. They try different ways to couple the input and the output in the recurrent connection, because the recurrent connection is all about input affecting the hidden state. So they provide a different mathematical way to do it. So instead of the multiplicative connections, these guys tried another dynamic and called it multiplicative integration. Instead of learning those weights, which brings higher burden to training and it will be more difficult to converge, they just apply Hadamard's, which is element-wise multiplication, Hadamard's multiplication, instead of this addition, guys. Remember when I just changed this formula, I've defined, we could just always partition this matrix into two so that we can represent this multiplication as two multiplication of matrices. Instead of adding them, it makes an element-wise multiplication. So k elements being multiplied. Well, which is simpler, but the dynamics is more complex, which means in the hypothetical hyperspace of features, you can create more complex surfaces, which you may need for some reason. So that's the multiplicative integrated LSTM, which is a bit different from the multiplicative LSTM, but which is an idea inherited or emerged from the multiplicative LSTM. That's another idea. As you can see, but the idea is the same. They are trying to make the relation of the hidden state with the input something different than a linear one, trying to make it more complex. There are cases that works, but I mean, it was first proposed, multiplicative LSTM was first proposed by Krause et al. In 16, 5 years ago. I mean, you can create complicated versions of it because you're just changing that linear nature, right? There is one I've heard about, before when I was preparing slides, I just wondered, is there a famous multiplicative network application, multiplicative LSTM application? And did they find something that was useful for? There is something here, OpenAI's answer. I found something from some blog. The most well-known of this implementation of multiplicative LSTMs are this one, apparently, and I've got the link. If you're interested, please visit the link. Sorry. And apparently, this is a very short summary of what was happening about multiplicative LSTMs, and just these guys found out that by pre-training a big multiplicative LSTM on unsupervised text prediction, it became much more capable and could perform at high level on NLP tasks with minimal fine-tuning. So it's just, they've come up with some minor or maybe major contributions. If you're interested, please read it. But if you ask me, LSTM was the title. LSTM is that boxer who is knocked down, including everyone, including multiplicative LSTMs. And finally, maybe the most important variant, because this variant is not a modification on LSTM, it's a coupling of LSTM. It's like two LSTMs marrying each other, marrying. Let's see what it is. Again, similar to multiplicative LSTMs, to understand BLSTMs, we should understand bidirectional recurrent neural networks. Bidirectional recurrent neural networks is just simply, you put two independent RNNs together in opposite directions, which means while you're feeding the input to one of them in the forward direction, you feed the same sequence to the other one in the opposite direction. However, you obtain the output as a combination of the both. So it is like you are feeding two separate sequences, these sequences being the reverse of each other and inverse of each other. And you are feeding them simultaneously to two separate LSTMs, which you separately train. And at each sequence input, because their length is the same, because one of them is the inverse of the other, at each step, you are combining their inputs. Actually, it's a very simple idea, but it works very well for some applications. So that's the idea, bidirectional recurrent neural networks by Schuster and Kuldip and Palival. I don't know what I'm saying. So it's simple. So guys, you are feeding zero, for example, then one, that's something, because this is the hidden state, sorry. The hidden state is initially always zero. Hidden state being zero. Since it's in the reverse order, it's on the other side, right-hand side, zero. You're feeding this input here, and you're feeding this input here. As you can see, you feed them, and while you're calculating the output, you're using the hidden states of these guys together. So two sequences being fed together. However, to obtain the output, you are using the corresponding hidden states. So the famous sentence, everybody on the internet use this sentence, I love mango juice, you feed to one sequence. To the other sequence, you are Yoda, you feed juice, mango, love eye. It doesn't make much sense for this kind of an example because language is usually in a single direction. If you're not Yoda, language is something that you can understand in a single direction. But this is not the case for many sequences. I mean, when you feed them in two separate directions, maybe you just observe, or your network observe or discover some relations better compared to a single direction feed. That could be the case. So while you're doing this, you're feeding these two separate sequences, you obtain two separate hidden states. And you just use these corresponding hidden states to get the output layer. And the LSTM is the same, I mean. But before LSTM, the slide. The idea behind the bidirectional recurrent neural network is very straightforward, which involves replicating the first recurrent layer in the network, then providing the input sequence as an input to the first layer, and providing the reverse copy of the input sequence to the replicated layer. Just what you said, okay? This overcomes the limitations of traditional RNNs, in which the dependencies are one directional. So you've got dependencies in both directions, right? So the RNNs can be trained using all available input info. And in the past, Fisher and particular step, that's what it is. So LSTMs are just the same idea. Instead of the RNN, you just put that box of LSTMs. However, the activation gate, which is like the output layer, you combine, so this is the output layer, something like the output layer. You combine the cell states or the hidden states or both of them, or the separate sequences of the bidirectional LSTM. So we have two separate LSTMs, one for the forward sequence and for the backward sequence. And the hidden states of both LSTMs are concatenated to be fed to the output layer, the corresponding states. This one's states are concatenated and being fed to the output layer. And as I just said, the use of bidirectional LSTMs may not make sense for all sequence prediction problems, but they may offer some benefit in terms of better results to domains where it's appropriate. So if you're looking for dependencies in both directions, it may. Actually, we've done something like, do I have that slide? Yes. I'm always showing important people's and famous people's papers. I just wanted to put this. We have just recently tried something with Ohsan. What we did was we were trying to find a parameter of a control system, a second order control systems coefficient, the zeta, which is a coefficient related to the friction in a second order system. And we have fed the input output sequences. And we have tried, we've done a comparative study in which we tried GRU's LSTMs and BLSTMs. And BLSTMs were apparently working better in many different combinations of hyperparameters. BLSTMs were much better. So I guess this is one of the ones, this is one of the areas that they were better. So BLSTM cells, I mean, that's I've written a paragraph for the explanation. BLSTM cells, BLSTM cells with bidirectional gradient flow perform better than single direction gated recurrent cells, thus showing context in this case within a dynamical system sequence, which is this case, model correlated in a bidirectional manner when it comes to systems identification problems. So we could experimentally or empirically say this in this paper. Okay, these are my suggested readings. Read them. I think you now have a solid idea of LSTMs, how to change them, how they function. You can change the first weeks, in week three we did the live code. Change that live code to an LSTM. I'd recommend you do it because it's most probably going to be your base for your project if you're doing it on Python. I recommend you do it on Python. And in the following weeks, hopefully, we're going to have another live code session, if I can manage to finish it, combining CNNs with RNNs next week. Okay. Okay. Any questions?